Wave your hand, wave your hand, wave your hand from the Caribbean. Wave your hand, wave your hand, wave your hand from your one number one. For me ready for the competition. You not take intimidation. Let me, woman and man. We have no hand.
This is how we play the game.
This is how we play.
Hello and welcome to another edition of the Caribbean Premier League podcast. My name's Peter Miller. I'm hugely fortunate today to be joined by the excellent Mark Butcher. Hello, Mark. How are you?
Not feeling excellent, but it's very kind of you to say so.
Well, if you're anything like me, you've got a week planned of getting up at 2 o'clock in the morning to watch the Ashes, right?
That will be happening. Part. I mean, I was fortunate enough. Or misfortunate enough to have been working on the last two India Sri Lanka test matches for TV. So I was kind of up and awake and being paid reasonably well to watch those games and had the Ashes on at the same time. So, you know, although this time I won't be, there's not another test match to work on, so I'll be having to do it for free, which really bugs me.
Yeah, well, that's there's nothing worse. I'm not getting up to watch it for free. But it's a hard slog. Anyway, before we start talking about the Ashes, which I have to talk to because, you know, I'm talking to someone that single-handedly won a match at Headingley in 2001, so we need to come on to the Ashes at some point. But your thoughts on the CPL this year? I mean, what were your highlights from your side of the tournament? You were in Jamaica and Guyana, right? And Trinidad?
Yeah, Jamaica, Guyana, Trinidad. The first week was first 10 days or so was a bit of a blur because we arrived in St. Lucia, did one game in St. Lucia. St. Lucia sort of set down their credentials of being utterly hopeless on game one, losing by 10 wickets, I think, to Trinidad. And then we flew straight back to Trinidad, where they had all of their home games within the space of, blimey, I suppose it was 10 days. A brilliant, incredible atmosphere. Obviously, the team played bloody well, and the public came out and supported them at Queen's Park Oval in huge numbers. And it was a real spectacle. It kind of lived up to the hype of the biggest party in sport, particularly over there was a particular weekend, the last weekend, where they had four home games in the space of 5 days, and it was that was pretty magnificent. Then what did we do? We ended up. That was the next leg was Guyana. So, you know, went there, I suppose, a little bit less hyped, or people from outside the Caribbean wouldn't kind of imagine that the Guyana leg would have been any good. But in terms of the support that the team had and the amount of fun that the punters had at the stadiums, it was as good as Trinidad. You know, even though the games of cricket weren't anywhere near as good because the pitches at Guyana tended to be let's be kind and say dull, you know, but it didn't make any difference to the way that the punters came out and supported. So, you know, those first two legs, and obviously you've got that kind of whole sort of Indo-Caribbean thing going on in the South America and obviously down in Trinidad. And it was great, you know, the hospitality people, even some of the games were great, you know. It was really cool.
I mean, if you're talking of love of cricket in the Caribbean, it's Trinidad and Guyana. And I think perhaps people that haven't visited don't realise that. You know, if you're watching England test matches, for example, you're thinking of the packed houses at the Kensington Oval and all the rest of it. But if you're talking about people that are just absolutely obsessed with this sport and just will, you know, just totally, completely immersed in it, then it's Trinidad and Guyana. And almost Guyana's more crazy for cricket than Trinidad, which I don't think people necessarily think of. Like you quite rightly said, you know, Guyana's not an island, it's, you know, in South America, all those things going against it, perhaps. And perhaps it's not, if you were looking at a tour of the Caribbean as a tourist, you might not think about necessarily going to Guyana because it doesn't have the beaches and all the rest of it. But in terms of, there's a lot going for it in terms of the other stuff, you know, in terms of it being authentic and an interesting place to visit.
There's the Amazon for a start. The rainforest, which is something else. You know, if you ever get the chance to head out to Kaitua Falls, which I did year one, the first year I went out there, you know, and just go and see all that still natural, unspoiled stuff. You know, don't take any photographs of the brown overbaked tea that is the sea outside your window, but the inland stuff is bloody unbelievable.
But Trinidad as well. Trinidad's one of those places that's, you know, it's very industrial and very built up. But in terms of somewhere to go and have some fun, I don't think there's many places I've had more fun than Port of Spain. Port of Spain is just unreal. You know, I think one of my favourite memories from the CPL this year is eating doubles on a street corner at 3 a.m. with Danny Morrison. it's one of the more interesting things I've done with my time.
It's astonishing the amount of mornings you can find a Danny Morrison at 3 o'clock in the morning in Trinidad. It was brilliant. I mean, Darren Ganga was our sort of host. Obviously, he's Mr. TNT. Lara had obviously set up his 400 bar. Literally, you step out of the stadium and you're in Brian's bar that he had set up for the whole of the home matches of the Trinidad team, the TKR team. Plus, you have that sort of in terms of hospitality and fun and nightlife, and then you know you're out onto the ocean. Sort of zipping in and out of the coves on boats and people just sort of like dropping anchor and having parties while you're all, you know, everyone's in the water, you know, in the sea. It was just it was a magnificent experience. You know, and there was some cricket being played too.
Well, you know, cricket's obviously an ancillary benefit to all of this, really, isn't it? It's it was great. I mean, I suppose, you know, from a Trinbago Knight Riders point of view, you were saying how they played magnificently. Could you tell perhaps from that, you know, they absolutely demolished St Lucia in that first game, which became a bit of a theme throughout the tournament as their struggles continued. But could you tell that they were a championship side from that very
They had a lot of things going for them, didn't they? I mean, Colin Munro had a terrific tournament with the bat. Obviously, Brendan McCullum, you have him in your side, and he brings, in terms of trying to sort of like bond together a bunch of players from all over the world in one of these very short tournaments, having somebody like Baz around is relatively handy because he's been there, seen it, done it all. They also had Sanam Narine, who's reprised role as a sort of top order smasher and one of the most unhittable bowlers in T20 cricket was also great. And the rest of the bowling attack was also fantastic. Dwayne Bravo was injured in the early parts and he grew in terms of his fitness and confidence through the rest of the tournament. They had a lot more depth than anybody else was able to call upon through the tournament.
Well, it was nice to see young players, young West Indies players coming through as well. Kevin Cooper was fantastic, played a very important innings in that final at the Brian Lara Cricket Academy Stadium, and then also bowled pretty well throughout and has been rewarded with a West Indies call-up as a result, which is fantastic to see. I think the bowler I think that impressed me most when I watched TNT, and I missed that home leg, so I saw them less than some did, although I did see them in the finals week, was Shadab Khan, who I think is one of the more impressive bowlers kicking around. And as well, you know, I suppose the question to ask you...
He bats too.
Yeah, he bats too. And I suppose the question to ask you is how important, now that people can't bowl doozers with the massive clampdown on people and their extension of their elbows, how important has leg spin become in 2020 cricket?
Yeah, I mean, I always think it's been a huge part of it. But yeah, when you're not allowed to have the other sort of mystery, then I suppose it becomes even more important. But you know, the great thing that leg spinners have to their advantage in all T20 cricket is the fact that people have to hit them. You know, so you can actually bowl rubbish and take loads of wickets. It's bowling rubbish is quite a good thing. Being predictable is your worst enemy really in T20s. And so you know, you don't have to. You know, and this is, I'm not besmirching Rash from Yorkshire, but you know, one of the reasons why he is so much more effective in limited overs form, particularly in T20, than he is ever was in Test matches, is because people have got to score off you every ball, and that split second it can take you to decide whether or not it's a top spinner, a googly, or a leggy, is the difference between you hitting it out of the park and not being able to get it anywhere. So, yeah, I mean, he's been huge. The fella from Afghanistan, sorry, it's early in the morning, I can't remember his name.
Rashid Khan.
He's, you know, he's also invaluable, you know, a sort of a superstar in the making. You know, made his bones in the IPL of all places. So, you know, these guys are going to be highly sought after all around the world in these leagues.
Yeah, I mean, Rashid Khan obviously took a hat-trick in the finals week as well with three googlies. I don't think any of the three batsmen that were bowled, all of them bowled all googlies, I don't think any of them picked it, which is obviously a big advantage to have a googly that people can't pick. And as well, you know, if you look at his figures, I mean, granted, he's not been playing top level opposition in ODI cricket, but if you look at players that have bowled 2,000 balls in ODI cricket, he's got the best average of any of them. Something like 13.4. And I think, you know, that'll regress to the mean when he moves up that level and starts playing higher level opposition more regularly. But yeah, I mean, absolutely fantastic player.
Maybe, yeah, it may do. I mean, from his point of view, the difficulty is going to be that the other guys, when he's representing Afghanistan without the sort of like the backup of world-class players in his team from franchise cricket, it's not necessarily that he bowls any worse or players pick him any better. It's just that what's going on around him is not quite as good in terms of creating pressure. So people may well be able to get away with not having to treat him so harshly. And that might take his wicket-taking capabilities down because they're able to get easy pickings elsewhere. But that's for another day, I guess.
I suppose you've seen that a little bit with Sonny Lorraine for the West Indies, haven't you? Where people have said, if you bowl four overs for 15 and you don't take any wickets, I'm happy. I'll just try and take...
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the things about, about people that don't rate franchise cricket in terms of its cricketing value, I suppose, is that quite often you end up with bowling attacks that are better than the ones that you will find in international cricket. And, you know, but not all the time, but in the better franchise teams, you can end up with bowling attacks that have more variety and more skill in them than the odd international team.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I know you've been a big advocate of franchise cricket around the world, especially in England. I've enjoyed your various conversations with George DeBell on the Cricket Info podcast on this very subject. So we won't rehash it. If anyone is a fan on such things, I recommend you check in the Butch and DeBell show. It's always very entertaining to listen to two people eloquently arguing their point. Anyway, enough about the Caribbean. I've got you on. I need to ask you a little about the Ashes. The Ashes are going on at the moment. Obviously, things haven't gone particularly well for England. There's the Perth test coming up. England have won once in Perth ever, and that was when all of the best players were off playing World Series cricket for Kerry Packer.
The jam are a year old, so, you know.
what are the chances of England actually getting anything other than a series losing defeat out of this?
Well, I'm going to, despite myself, I'm going to try and be very positive for you here.
Good. I need it.
I had England losing the Perth Test match. In fact, you know, you pretty much on an Aussie tour, you kind of put that one down as a loss, and you almost 75% say the same about Brisbane, which made Adelaide vitally important, obviously, with it being day, night and everything. And England showed sort of in the second half of the match what might have happened had they perhaps made the right decision at the toss, or having made the decision at the toss, then bowled better in the first innings. But there you go, you're 2-0 down going to Perth. Not a great situation to be in. However, pitches at Perth for Ashes Test matches tend to buck the trend. People keep saying that the WAC has lost its pace. It's not got the pace that it used to have. But they say that before every single Ashes Test match, and then the pitch produced for England Australia game is an absolute flyer. So if that is the case, and if Australia's batting is just as prone to calamity as ours is, you can luck yourself a win in Perth if that's the case. If the pitch happens to be dead flat, then I think we're screwed. But if it's not, if it's traditional WACA, then you've got a fighter's chance of being able to do something. I wouldn't like to have to put my money on England winning in Perth to be able to get back in a series. It has to be said, but it's not the end. It isn't the end until it's the end, I suppose.
Yeah, I suppose. I mean, there's obviously lots of stuff going on in and around the squad that I saw you talking about on the BBC last night, which we won't go into here. But I mean, just from a cricketing point of view, it was good to see what this England side are capable of in that second half of that test in Adelaide. And as you quite rightly said, the frustrating thing was they didn't do it for the whole of a test. And that's been the two first tests so far, really, hasn't it? Like in Brisbane, they were competed for the first half of the test and then fell away in the second. And then in the Adelaide test, they were terrible for the first half of the test and then competed in the second half. And you're not going to beat Australia in Australia unless you compete over all of the days, and you need to win 2 out of 3 sessions in a day every day.
Yeah, well, I mean, England's kind of, if you look at England's performances in test matches, on the whole, for the last, I don't know, for the last 2 years, I suppose, they've played like that at home and away, you know, where they've been competitive, or they've been brilliant, or they've been utterly shambolic. So it shouldn't come as any great surprise that when you're already sort of second favourites to win an Ashes series away from home, that all of that stuff is manifesting itself in the space of individual test matches, let alone the series. I mean, you know, the issues are so wide ranging, aren't they? You've got the England's biggest strength. I was talking about this on the Beeb last night. That England's biggest strength has been their all rounders. Has been sort of six to eight or even 9 if you include Chris Wokes. And none of those guys, well, one of them's not there, and the rest of them are all having to play roles that are slightly different from the ones that they would normally do if they were all there playing and doing their normal job. Moeen Ali's at 6 instead of at 8. Johnny Bairstow's got no one batting behind him, whereas he would normally have Mo behind him. Ben Stokes isn't there. Chris Wokes is batting a position higher than he would normally be. All of these things kind of like a messing around with what England's great strength has been. In the periods where they've been successful over the last couple of years. So that doesn't help. And, you know, the lack of runs in the top order just absolutely kills you, because more than anywhere else in the world, in Australia, your batters have to score the runs and your bowlers have to take the wickets. You don't get away with scoring your runs from 7 downwards to keep you in test matches, because Australia's bowlers with extra pace and bounce on those pitches just blow away the lower order. Chris Wokes' average... Chris Wokes is a very, very, very competent lower order batsman, but you could knock 10 off his average in Australia. You know what I mean? It's just so much more difficult for guys who are not specialist batsmen to score runs down there. And so therefore the guys in the top 5 or 6 have got to do it, and they're not.
So what you're saying is Cook scores a double 100 and Jimmy takes 10 wickets and England win.
That's what I'm saying. Funnily enough, actually, this can very much depend on the way that they bowl at Alistair in this test match. But the you know, he's made 100 in Perth before. I think it was his first Ashes 100 was in Perth. And you know, the stumps or sort of like the outside edge of the bat being taken out of play a little bit by the extra bounce and pace that might be there is something that can help him out. Unless, of course, you know, Cummins or Stark or what's his face?
Hazelwood.
Hazelwood happened to bowl in the same manner that that old Ryan Harris did, which was just get it as full as you possibly can. I mean, the slightly concerning thing for Alistair is that that sort of foible that he has in his technique, which you know, people like Michael Holding just say, well, I have no idea how this bloke has ever scored a run back in the way that he bats, is that sometimes he gets himself so far back in the crease that he cannot get himself back forward again. He's never been a big strider forward. But at times when the timing is off, he just cannot get himself in front of the crease, even though he's trying to. And so he throws his hands at it and he nicks it. And that's what looks like going on at the moment. Hopefully he's managed to iron something out in the time off that he's had between these test matches. Otherwise, that stretch will go on a little further, and KP will be able to come up with some more gems, reprising his own removal from the side as to why Alistair should be removed from it too.
I do love Kevin. I'm a big fan. The thing to take away from it, I suppose, is just that the senior players haven't done as well as they needed to, and the up and coming guys are always going to struggle in Australia. That's kind of my takeaway from it, really.
Yeah, I mean, who had England winning this series? I didn't.
No, not a chance. No, I think I said 4-1.
Yeah, I said a three match difference between the two sides. Exactly my thoughts. But the disappointing thing, I suppose, is that they're not that great side themselves, you know, Australia. But their bowling attack, being that they've all managed to be fit at the same time, and also, I'm so pleased that Nathan Lyon's bowled magnificently. It's another bugbear of mine with George. We've argued about for the last 2 years about whether Nathan Lyon is a better bowler than Moeen Ali. I'm leaving it there for everyone. Just there it is.
George De Bell of ESPN Cricket Info is a wonderful man, but he's fiercely loyal to those he loves, and sometimes
he certainly is. And I love him for it, but crikey, you know, Lyon has been nothing short of magnificent the last 18 months. And you put those three quick bowlers on the same part together, and you can see how potent Australia, you know, can be everywhere in the world as long as they're able to put them on the part, because they're bloody magnificent. Hazelwood is, what do I call him, McGrath on steroids. Cummins just looks like an extraordinarily good cricketer, and Mitchell Stark is just, you know, the tail enders, just forget about it. Might as well not bother.
Well, and as England have two number 11s, almost three number 11s in this side, so it's well, I mean, maybe it's slightly different now. Overton's there. Overton's a better player than Jake Ball is with the bat by a long, long way. I suppose, you know, to finish off in terms of talking about Lyon, Lyon's kind of done what Swan did in the 2010-11 tour, in that he's both able to just keep the scoring rate down if there's nothing in it for him and allow the quicks to rotate, and then also the ability to take wickets as well when the pitch starts turning and doing something for him, which they tend to on Australia. Yeah. That's the thing, is Australian pitches do tend to wear and do tend to start turning, and that extra pace and bounce makes the spinners that much more effective, which is what we saw in Brisbane and in Adelaide.
I mean, you know, at the risk of being sounding condescending, but that's kind of what a spinner's supposed to do.
Yeah.
You know, in England, we think that that's some kind of miraculous sorcery when they do that. But that's what a spinner's supposed to do. That's a proper spin bowler.
We just haven't had one of them very often as English fans.
And... No, exactly. But you know, and part of the reason for that, I think, is because in general, in our cricket, at all levels, our expectations of spinners are just so low, you know, just kind of don't think that they're of any use. And so therefore, you know, players who become reasonably good at it are seen as being this extraordinary marvel, when really all they're doing is basically what you're supposed to do.
This is all very true. So Lathan Lyon's doing what he's supposed to do, which is great for Australia and not so good for England. Right, let's wrap this up. Thank you so much for your time this morning, Mark. I really appreciate it. Hopefully next time I see you, it'll be in the sunshine of the Caribbean.
Let's hope so.
Take care and speak soon.